A very good evening and welcome to the Fourth Estate. Charles Mwangushampagi, I am your host. And tonight, we will be taking a wrap of the major stories that dominated news during the week, touching no specific subject, but discussing the things that dominated news headlines during the week. And as we begin taking stock of the year 2014, we're crossing into December, and we'll be taking stock of 2014 as we prepare for the year 2015. One of the major events of the week was the major conference organized by civil society organizations and opposition political parties that was officially boycotted by the National Resistance Movement that came up with a list of electoral and constitutional reforms they believe will make Uganda a more electoral democracy, a better electoral democracy going forward. Let me introduce the colleagues in the studio with me tonight. Chris Obore, Investigations Editor at the Daily Monitor. Chris, very nice to have you always.
Thank you very much. Why don't you say me a panelist at Fourth Estate?
A panelist at Fourth Estate?
Yes.
Because I need to introduce you. You're a panelist at Fourth Estate. See, for how many years? So why did you keep saying that?
You know the danger of titles in this world? Sometimes those things. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Better be Charles Mwangushe.
I am.
Even if we want to respect you, father can say Mr. Mwangushe.
That's what I am.
So that's what we want. More. But if we want titles, those ones are just, how do they call it? They are given and
they
removed.
Can be taken away.
But Mwangushe will remain.
Okay.
Yeah.
Most welcome. Wanamba Richard is a journalist at the Daily Monitor.
Thank you, Charles.
Very nice to have you. And veteran journalist, that's what they call you.
I thought you are going to say a former journalist.
He's still a journalist.
Retired. I put it at the Hank from Teso.
The Hank from Teso.
The Hank from Teso on Apito.
You know, interestingly, we are running a show tonight that is of the wise men from the East. You know, there were three. The wise men from the East. All of them. We can actually change and discuss. Do the show in Ateso, because he speaks very good Ateso. And mine has no, I'm trying to polish it a little bit. Maybe I will learn it.
You will have made history for having hosted an Ateso show on KFM. Then also host one on NTV. It had never happened. These days, even Radio Uganda and UBC don't capture Ateso activities. So you'll have made history, Charles Double. We'll give you a very nice lady, young lady for that.
We'll find an opportunity to discuss that. And can you talk to the chief? He should find
Emor. You have the chief here. Take the message.
Chris, let me start with you. We have a discussion that brings together 1,000 Ugandans drawn from all walks of life. I saw you in the corridors of Hotel Africana on Monday. This discussion about electoral and constitutional reform. What were your impressions of the conference, number one? Number two, the behind the scenes and where you think this effort can go, especially given that the major political contenders were part of this discussion, but only from the opposition, and the National Resistance Movement stayed away.
I have had a position on that matter, that it is a worthwhile effort, but I don't think it is going to change much for now because of the level we have reached as a country. And I've also said that the civil society effort minus the NRM effort will not take us anywhere. And I think that still it shows that either there is no ability to broker consensus in Uganda or just that people deliberately don't want consensus. One, it is so disheartening that the ruling party was not present. And yet for us to achieve these reforms, you need a point of convergence of those getting for them and arguing from those who are in power. You can't ignore any. But apparently, it seems those in the government are either ignoring those who are trying to bring new ideas, or those bringing new ideas are not using methods that can comfort those who already have power so that they come on board. And that, to me, is a very difficult situation in Uganda. And then the other is that I think sometimes we are giving a lot of emphasis to civil means to try to wrestle consensus from President Museveni for what we think is good for the country. But I think we do not know Museveni properly, or those who are attempting to do it. You need to understand Museveni's methods and Museveni's interests. And I don't think his methods involve building consensus and listening to people and taking what people believe. there are only two things I think President Museveni will respect. One, will respect a Mwangusha who was able to marshal artillery. If Mwangusha has AK-47 and is able to bring two more numbers to with AK-47, he will say, wait a minute, who else is supporting him? He will talk to you. Or,
but
a Mwangusha,
the country has,
I'm saying this,
is moving in reverse.
No, not at all. I'm just saying
that's the only way that can resolve this issue.
For you to change, you must understand the methods of the person you want to change. I'm only trying to bring them to the fore. The other is, if you are militarily strong, or if you offer any military threat to President Museveni, he will at least try to listen to you, even if he doesn't believe that in talking to you. The other is, a Mwangusha or anybody must have overwhelming respect from people of Toro, people of Busoga, people of Teso, that he begins to imagine if you moved with a block from Toro, you threaten him, he will listen to you. As of now, there are very few people who have the political clout to even cause him to say anything, let me talk to them. He has been damaging the ability of leaders to marshal their own political backyards that they can use to say, if you don't talk to us, you don't have this. What does our see deployed? Divide and rule, you will go to Bugisu, use the Umukuka against the other one, against the other. He merges and uses the gun, which most people don't want, because the military actually runs our politics.
One quick question before I turn to the other guys on the show.
Yes.
Behind the scenes, what was the discussion within the National Resistance Movement to decide whether to attend or not to attend? I mean, in this case, not to attend.
Charles, don't abuse your intelligence. There is no entity called National Resistance Movement. The movement is more in disarray itself. The movement needs redemption from its own collapse. So you should be telling me what's the discussion within Museveni. What does he feel? And then that would require you to understand the nucleus that forms Museveni's politics.
I'm basing my question on one thing. The Speaker of Parliament was invited much, much earlier. She had confirmed she would attend. The conference organizers indicate they changed the closing time to accommodate the speaker because she was expected to be there in the morning. And then all of a sudden, she doesn't show up, doesn't give an explanation.
Mwangusha, NRM has no organs, has no systems to discuss how to respond to matters arising. NRM has one organ, Yoweri Museveni. The Speaker of Parliament is only as strong when Yoweri Museveni wants her to be strong. And when he doesn't want her to do anything, she will not do it.
Okay. Wana.
Yes, Charles.
I'll call you Wana because that's the way we refer to each other. But Mr. Onambo, if you look at the organization, I need to make some declaration of interest. I was closely following what was going on and somewhat involved in what was going on. But the question is, the invitation was, leave the political interests aside. Let's have a discussion for the country. And there was indication that the people in the ruling NRM were either approached in their individual capacities as leaders or should have been attending in that capacity. There was an official invitation to the party. There was an official invitation to the president, and he doesn't show up, but no one else from an official angle shows up for this discussion. There are two things. Chris raises some of them. Is what do you think, does this country think is going to deliver it if a peaceful, organized discussion cannot? And people look back and say, the Moshi Conference resolved a Uganda that was on fire, but they had to go to a foreign country to discuss that. Others will refer to the 1985, what were called the Nairobi peace jokes. When the country was on fire, you go and sit, but of course that didn't come amount to anything because President Museveni, who was then the leader of the rebel NRA, said if one person dies in Uganda overnight, this thing has collapsed, and it's collapsed like that. What was going on? What is the thing? What are you hearing that people are saying?
First of all, I don't know at what time the organizers of the event invited the NRM to participate, whether it was early or late, and we also want to know whether they received the invitation. First of all, like you say, it was an important conference. It wouldn't be good for one of the main dominants in Uganda today, that's the NRM, to miss. But you also know that NRM, like Chris said, is in this area. They have internal problems. It could be true that they received the invitation, but who could represent them? Of course, if the invitation was addressed to the president, it was upon the president to delegate. But in this case, they said they didn't receive. The organizers say we invited them. So the question is, NRM could have discarded the whole thing as we shouldn't participate in it to give mileage to the organizers, to give mileage to the opposition. You remember this whole thing started around January when the opposition and civil societies went across the country calling for electoral reforms. And within NRM, there are few people who are not impressed. It was until the international COP, diplomatic COP, had to intervene, and the meeting was held in Kololo between IGP, Minister for Internal Affairs, that they were given space. So to the NRM, I think they didn't want to give credit to the opposition. They just wanted to play it, cool. It goes on, no mileage. And the organizers...
Do you think they have succeeded in that?
Yeah, because they are the majority. They are the majority as far as Uganda is concerned. They have the numbers. They are in power. And if you don't participate in a major conference like that, I think this somehow
managed. It doesn't affect you significantly.
Yeah.
Ona, you've been watching these things longer than all of us have.
I'm not sure.
How do you resolve political questions if the only approach you have been used to is the gun and people are saying the gun has run out of currency?
Charles, what happened at Hotel Africano, I would compare it to having the right prescription but trying to give it to the wrong patient. Everything that was decided in Africana is really what you'd consider classic elements of a democracy, for free and fair election. But remember, whenever such conferences or resolutions have been made and then implemented, you are talking of a collapsing state or a state that is beleaguered. That's why you are talking of Moshi when Amin was going, 85 when Obote was gone and the Okellos could not hold. NRM today is farthest from a collapsing state. At least it does not believe so, and many of its supporters do not believe so. So NRM considers whatever was decided in Africana irrelevant. They have a system that they're in control. They are able to hold elections, whether you say the laws are faulty and tilted. So you cannot get a government that is not collapsing to accept civil society resolutions to change the constitution, to change electoral laws. So I think the timing of this is not right. The environment is not there. The NRM is so confident, it is simply ignored.
But some
ignored whatever happened in Africana. It does not feel it threatens it, does not feel it can affect it.
In 2011, there were efforts by multiple groups of people to try and cause a presidential debate. And President Museveni wouldn't be part of anything, because I think he believed the same then. And you worked for the president, so you know how he feels about the people on the other side trying to challenge him. But is that a sustainable way?
Well, I think it will be sustainable until when President Museveni feels genuinely weak and threatened, or until the NRM feels... Right now, the NRM feels it can set the rules and it can win, according to those...
So you think
the,
I think Charles,
and the opposition is genuinely still weak. The civil society is weak. The population is not conscious enough to agree with them to put pressure on the government.
I think what Ona is saying, well, maybe we say that NRM perceives itself not to be collapsing. Even when the collapse is imminent. That's what that's the difference we can see. But sometimes you don't know how sick you are.
Tombstones have been written so repeatedly. I was reading an article the other day about the collapse of the printed newspaper. And they are saying when TV came on board, they wrote a tombstone for newspapers. They survived that. When FM radio came, they wrote another tombstone. Now internet has come, they have written another tombstone. And even the tombstone for the NRM has been written so many times, but it's not collapsing.
The mistake we make then is if you are relating a state collapse to a collapse of a human being, then you miss the point. The collapse of the state is reflected in the well-being of each and every individual. I can tell you under NRM, there is more grief than happiness. And that shows that there is no well-being of the people. And once people you are running, their well-being is an issue of concern. you as a state loses legitimacy. And that we know the NRM is not popular because of legitimacy. State legitimacy is got through the results of government programming. And government programming have not impacted positively on a larger section of the population. You are going to see a sprinkling of good cars and good houses. It doesn't reflect that the country is okay. So from that perspective, we know the state has collapsed. But if we go to the issues of Nambole, I mean of Hotel Africana, the trouble is that this, because of this grief from the population, people are tired of lip service. Now, Africana is seen as a group of those elite also, who are not in the government, who think politics of rhetoric can help remove Museveni. Yet Museveni is far from that. That's why I'm prescribing a solution to those who even want to change government or to force Museveni to speak to other stakeholders. The only way is start by having a leader who is powerful genuinely at home. Mm-hmm. The leaders we see right now, whether in opposition or in NRM, are deliberately made by a wrong system or deliberately made by Museveni. So you find today an MP who is not even sure of being a leader the next term. That's not a man Museveni can negotiate with. That's not even a man who can initiate and say, we need to talk about this country. A person who needs to have a talk, you must have your point of dominance. What is your political power?
If you
realize in Kenya, Raila can call for talks, and who will have to listen? Because Raila is a bull in his own crowd. The fans you see here are castrated bulls around.
Let's examine that a little more. Before we come on air, we're discussing population numbers. And we're looking at the position of Teso, or Itesot.
Itesot.
Where they were at some time back, where they are in the latest census figures, and you're asking a question about those power centers. There is a time you wouldn't have a discussion without picking up names in the Bushenyi region who could be considered as genuine leaders among the Ankole people, or in Imbarara.
But not anymore.
You would look at a region like Toro and find people you would consider regional leaders who any politician worth his name had to go to before they could. You would find that in Buganda, you'd find that in Northern Uganda. That has all disappeared. What does that mean?
And I can talk, look, I that was deliberate. And I can talk about Teso, who a big population, but they are malnourished bulls from Teso. They can't stand this big bull called Museveni.
You don't look like a malnourished bull.
Politically malnourished bulls. Politically malnourished bulls here, Charles.
But how can you compare a long-horned bull and a zebra? That is unfair. These are two different types of bulls.
I think, of course,
the administrative structure of Uganda, not just under NRM since independence, has been changing. The British demarcations of territories, the big Ankole Teso, allowed leadership to emerge at a bigger stage. But now when you started creating more districts, sub-counties, now you're actually allowing so many individuals to emerge and then nobody wants to respect the other.
Yes, no one is bigger than the other, no one can hold sway.
But also I think the approach to politics, which Obora has been emphasizing, is wrong. We all want to come to Kampala before a microphone appear on Fossa State and think we are important, we are making an impact. The people on the ground actually don't know you.
The difference is, we're taking a break. We're taking a break, we'll pick it up maybe. The difference with this is that the organizers of the conference, to their credit, put together 15 regional conferences following the traditional regions.
Yeah, but Bugisu, they did not have representatives in those regions. This was a traveling lot from Kampala moving to regions. When they leave no impact. They come with their impact.
In other words, who from Toro would you consider a rallying leader from Toro? Who would meet a rallying leader from Acholi, a rallying leader from Kigezi and say, Yoweri Museveni, we need discussions?
The question may not be on the organization, it might be, do those leaders exist? Let's take a break and come back to this discussion. We'll be right back. welcome back. You're still watching the Fourth Estate, and we are discussing a news wrap of the major events that dominated news headlines during the week on the Fourth Estate. And we started with this effort to remake or redirect the course that the country is taking, especially if it wants to genuinely pursue an electoral approach to its democracy. Let's come back to the question of these regional power centers or individuals that emerge. I want to start with the elder, then I will come to Anambo. A few years ago, when someone talked about elders in the Chigezi sub-region, it remains at least among the still a little bit more homogeneous. You can go back and point to, the other day it was the Ruhakana Rugundas are still there, Amama Mbabazi. You'd come to Shenya and look for people like the Richard Keijukas, you'd look for the... You look for people like the Yona Kanyomoses from the Great Ankole region. The Yona Kanyomoses, you look for people like Manya Mushegas. How come, if you were to organize a conference like the civil society and the opposition put together, what names are those of people you would say in the current establishment that should have been at Nambole? Because that's also important. See, who is actually putting this pressure?
Is it Nambole or Africana?
Africana.
Look, I think when you mention some of those names and even names way back in the 60s, there's one characteristic. These are people who started leadership from school, people who built some kind of career. You are typical politician of today, centered around parliament. Really, I was in that parliament, and you know, often the people who make it to parliament, one, they don't have a background that can be really say that they are grounded in their regions. Some of them have not even built a homestead in their regions. Maybe they are straight out of school. So I think if you are to build regional leaders, you need first of all people who get grounded in the countryside. You know, people who either have worked in government, have been business, but they need to develop a strength in the countryside.
The question is,
I struggle to find those people today.
In Teso, for example. In Teso.
And in many other parts of the country.
No, in Teso, who would you have expected to be at Nambole?
No, I can't.
I know Chris would have nominated you if you had been.
No, I'm also a Kampala wannabe. I'm not grounded.
But at least you've been on the ground before, so you are considered a leader.
Yes. Who are those major missing names that, if they moved around the city, you would feel the ground shaking? Maybe that's what missed out, because that would have dictated how people react.
Of course, nature has not been good to us. Most of them have gone, but there are a couple of them still available. But like you said, many people, especially those who subscribe to the NRM, wouldn't come because their party had not nominated them, or they fear to participate in a conference where your party boss is not. But I saw a few people like Muchitale who gave speeches, and they're wonderful. But of course, the issue about
Muchitale as the leader from Bunyoro now.
Yeah, Bunyoro.
Would you call him that?
Yeah, he's a leader. Of course, the issue about these near citizens. Of course, others, you know, the equations in the politics of the country has changed. It's no longer where someone emerges, comes on his own, he's a leader, he's a nationally acceptable. He goes to guru, you say this on appeal to everybody, say, oh, this is the man. We no longer have such leaders. You kind of leaders who emerge, you have Honorable Gwang here, who emerges tomorrow, the following day is not there. So, but you have senior citizens who are there because of the commercialization.
Have they retreated?
They haven't retreated.
From
the front line. But also the commercialization of politics. Most of those senior elders do not have money to buy votes, whereas these young people have the capacity and they are pushed by their parties. They will.
Chris, I see something fundamentally wrong with the country. If you can't point a finger and say that if you have a major national discussion, the following names must be there. And if they're going to be there, the nation is going to listen. And then there is something you talked about in the last segment, which was you say the NRM has you said it has collapsed. Is that what you said? It does not exist. But when you look, you say the population is not behind it. But when you see the people who welcome President Museveni the other day when he was coming from the United States, you find their people. He has a network of supporters.
Yes, support.
If I have not eaten food for 2 weeks and you're telling me go and line up on Entebbe Road and get $100, I would be stupid not to go. So don't mistake my going there to mean support. I am looking for how to survive. Survival is a reflex action, because hunger, thirst, and natural occurrences in human life, that when you feel thirsty, you need water. So you cannot say, me, I don't want water. Then you stop living. So don't mistake that for actual political support. But the bigger issue is that we are trying to connect today and our yesterday.
Mm.
And a nation that does not learn from...
To project forward.
Yes. Mm. That doesn't learn from its history as a problem. And I'm seeing now that we are actually disconnected from who we were. And therefore, we may not even be knowing where we are going. For instance, I was young, even before the independence. If there's anything to be talked about Toro, John Babiha would be the name. Yes, John Babiha. He said there was John Ace from Toro. There was a name. If you are talking about Teso, I recollect the Cuthbert Obuangor, the Throat Flying School wouldn't be there if Obuangor was not a voice in Parliament at that time, in the legislature. There are records that the generals were there. But today, I hardly see any name to place my fingers on in Teso, in Toro, in Kigezi. That means the conditions...
What about the Mukulas?
But really, what do you want me to talk about?
Where should the Ali Salasos be?
What do you talk about Ali Salasos, really?
Even if they are watching me now, really.
Mm. Who knows Alaso Pastiserere?
She's a secretary general
of what? Mm. Of what? Let's not. I'm looking at a bigger picture of Uganda. Alaso might even possible Kedia, nobody can say Alaso. It's not about how weakness.
What went wrong? Because
that is the question now. Let me answer the question now.
That's about Obuangor you're talking about. Imagine. At the time you're talking about him, he was a young leader.
Thank you.
Emerging leader.
Yes.
But now you can go back and refer to them. John Babiha emerged on the national stage still as young leaders. The Edward Kakonges, you talk about the engineers. You talk about in the more recent times, people who are still actually with us. The Butimes in Toro.
So Charles, let me answer you now.
What is the problem?
For anything to succeed, there must be necessary conditions. And the conditions at that time that brought up the so-called national leaders was the national spirit. That we are building Uganda, one Uganda, we are nationalists, we are getting away the white
patriotic
man, patriotic people. And Kigezi and Gulu were all looking at an illusory good Uganda. It was illusory because right now the Uganda we're having, we would even prefer to be the one on the people likes, the one of the whites. So the problem now is, that's why I asked the beginning that we must understand the methods of President Museveni. I think one of his greatest methods is building himself. And he has done that very well. That even in the opposition, we don't have leaders who are seen as national leaders.
In character.
Mm. Even in the NRM, it's actually worse in the NRM. NRM has not helped the situation that we need to build national characters. You go to Busoga, the fight in Busoga. In fact, in Busoga, it is a crime for you to be seen to have become somebody powerful. In Teso, it's a crime because President Museveni sits somewhere and he decides. If anybody in Toro tried to build himself or herself as a leader, and that building does not benefit from Museveni, that person will be slashed.
Could you see
I just want to come in to back Chris's the disappearance of respected leaders.
Hmm.
One of the important things in society and almost in all species is what they call pedigree. And you find this in all the serious societies, all societies which have seemed to be successful. Certain traits have run through families,
mm-hmm.
you know. But one of the tragedies of Uganda has been that all the families of the 60s, the great families, where some of the national leaders mm-hmm. came from, have disappeared.
Why?
And you have each time there is a stop-start process. Mm-hmm. So you are not able to sustain pedigree. See, part of the problem is that the earlier leaders also did not help their kids, for example, to grow up in political consciousness. The kind of thing you are finding in Kenya, where Odinga is basically inheriting his father's mantle. Kenyatta, the same story, and a lot of other leaders. There is an element of pedigree, and society actually believes in pedigree and respects it.
Mm.
But then you have some people who have no background
from
nowhere. Mm. Even in the US, where you have had Obama, Clinton, who are the exceptions, most of the political leaders, even in the UK, have an element of pedigree. They have been Family leadership, and the question family is, businesses, these things are very critical.
Don't you think we have the same here? Don't you think we have the same
question
here?
Is,
Boris Kajimu, Akena here.
No, but the point is, they are there, yeah. But I think their fathers did not help them to get the best.
And I also think that given the example of Uhuru Kenyatta. I think Uhuru Kenyatta, by the time his father died, he was a young boy. I doubt whether the father mentored him and taught him how
to... But he had made the ground for him to be able to emerge.
Yeah,
he made
the ground.
You mentioned something interesting. You mentioned Morris Kajimuchi Wanuka. And if you did such just outside here. No, just go to the newsroom behind and ask people if they know who Morris Kajimuchi Wanuka is and what his claim to fame would be. Does that define the president of this country?
Hold on, this is a very big, important point. Mm. It's important to have pedigree. It's important to have the strong families. That is only if the traits there are for good leadership. But what is important is to have conditions that allow anybody
to go into your current, current first family.
Yes, no, hold on. I can give you, my father-in-law was a doctor from a humble background, but we became one of the youngest leaders in Teso. One of the good leaders of the Congress Party. You get it? Because at that time, it didn't require to be a son of a rich person to be a leader. It is how you connected with the people. So what I'm seeing, even the emerging families are being destroyed. Even those with potential that don't have a pedigree are being destroyed. Because there is an alpha male called Yoweri Kaguta Museveni. So we must not rule that out. Here you're coming in. So if it is not in Museveni's interest,
but is it about Museveni? Because Museveni, look at President Museveni.
Yes.
President Museveni has said, you're talking about pedigree?
Yes.
President Museveni would not be one of those people who would claim pedigree.
He has an opportunity
in creating that pedigree through his offspring.
Yes.
But President Museveni emerged as a young person at entire school. He was emerging as a leader, and he has been able to sustain. What is wrong with the rest of the country?
If we want to go back and have this from the back, I mean from the grassroots, is that we need to change our education system. How we think about this, let me tell you, in the 60s, 70s, 80s, there was that exchange program for students who emerged. You go to Central Scholarship Committee, they allocate you a school to Chigezi. I'm a number from Ubugisu. I will go study in Chigezi with a Muchiga. I grew up knowing Uganda.
And you make a name there.
Mm. When you are would emerge from Kanung, go to Chigezi. A few people, the current minister for internal affairs, studied from senior one up to senior six at Kitugumu High. He speaks fluent actually.
So, Aronda Nyakirima,
you grew up knowing that the system has brought you up. But today,
what happens? Which school do you go to?
The irony then, what Charles is bringing, those who were brought up by that good system came to abuse the same system. I do not know how much of Kitugumu High School Aronda supports today, even when it's powerful. And in fact, when they are calling Kitugumu High School OBs, I don't think can even appear on a dinner.
But don't you think, Chris, that dilemma would have been resolved? Because that program created an Aronda Nyakairima. Now you'd expect that he would emerge as a national leader. Actually, he's a national leader. You can find him. There are people who have emerged. What is that that is going to build the next generation
it's
of Uganda?
Exactly what I was coming to. One, Aronda is a national leader, like anybody else, but in appointment, not in character. That we must accept. Character is something different. Anybody can become a national leader because you occupy a national position. But in your actions, you are not. Let's not even think that good leaders
He went and liberated Kitugumu from LRA.
Don't take us there. Let's focus on our leadership. We shall do an audit that one later. We can do an audit of their role. Let's not think that there are no good leaders in NRM. Even in the NRM, we must accept that there are people in NRM who ordinarily in a very open and merit system would make very powerful national leaders. But the trouble is, even them are affected by the same, they are trapped in the same problem, that we can't see them. That's why when they even choose a national consultation, it becomes a national quarreling session for 70 supporters. who are moving around the country, who has the money, who does this, who is a mobilizer, who did you say send. So that's what I'm saying. Do not ignore the role of individuals in history. World over, to bomb Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it took a decision of Harry Truman alone. To bomb the Twin Towers in the US, it took one man,
Osama
bin Laden. So don't say what I'm saying in Museveni. Why? It's about Museveni. Powerful individuals can make powerful decisions and also make powerful mistakes. In this case, there is a powerful mistake either by commission or mission Museveni is making by destroying the ability of other Ugandans to come as leaders and concentrating it around himself, and is playing like, you know,
but Obore, why I would contradict you. You started very well by saying Yoweri Museveni will respect those who demonstrate that they command their regions.
But he's killing them.
So how can he kill people if they are conscious of what is good for them and they decide what is good for them? He cannot force them otherwise. So to blame someone for the weaknesses of other people in their region.
For the weaknesses of 35 million other people.
It's not absolutely correct.
Otafiri opposed the split of Bushenyi.
Actually, not of Bushenyi only. All the districts.
All the districts. Otafiri. But tell me, other than his being minister, Otafiri now is taken to Mitoma, some terrible place there, that these are people don't even see him as a leader.
So what I'm saying is,
you have to help Otafiri by telling him.
Why can't Otafiri make himself?
Now, he's already in a pond. This happened in the pond.
That's
an argument.
Let's take a break. When we come out of the break, we'll be discussing non-politics. We'll be right back.
This could be...
Still watching the Fourth Estate, and welcome to the last segment. It's becoming a little bit heated and more interesting off and on the air.
Africana.
Let me come to you, Ona,
yes.
A little bit more. How can you blame? It's a debate we have had for a long time. How can you debate the failure of 34.9 million people on an individual?
Yeah, I agree with
Otafiri should have his own space. He has a responsibility to cover out his own space.
Yeah.
Amanya Mushega had his own responsibility to cover out his own space.
I absolutely agree with Obore that historical individuals have been so critical. But also I think in societies that have progressed, it has been the ability of the majority to resist, for example, either an individual or a group of individuals, if they genuinely believe those people are wrong. So let's take a question of Bushenyi. If Otafiri and other people believed that splitting Bushenyi was wrong,
no, Bushenyi and Bushenyi alone districts.
Just let's take Bushenyi for example.
Bushenyi because that one
that's where
they did not go the full length to fight and say no. Somehow they caved in, and this is what you see all over again. So you can't blame Yoweri Museveni if people in Teso are not able to unite and have a regional leader because you say he has gone there and stopped them. I mean, it's their weakness.
The people of Teso.
Leaders naturally, or human beings, want to control and to dominate. That's almost an instinct, whereby you want to take control, and if other people do not stop you, even you, Obore, you'll do it.
You talked about Teso, and I remember you talked about the show we did on KFM some years back, and then you had a gala. At the National Theatre.
Yes.
I haven't been invited to another one. What happened?
There was one yesterday, Teso Family Show.
It appears you missed the one. It appears you did only one. Teso has a responsibility to organize itself and emerge at a discussion like this, say, these are our people from Teso. They do not necessarily have to belong to the NRM, to FDC, to DP. They can be leaders. Previously, national leaders emerged from religious leaders, bishops. Archbishop Orombi represents the conscience of West Nile and can speak authoritative about West Nile, but at the national stage. Archbishop Luanga can represent that national conscience. You used to find some of these, but all these have disappeared. I had said that we're going to move on and discuss none of the political issues.
Charles,
one quick comment, Chris.
Yes. It is a quick and a serious comment, by the way, because these are at the core of what we are going to discuss even next.
Yeah.
If you, first of all, you make a statement, some writer made, when the madness of an entire nation disturbs a solitary mind, it's not enough to say the man is mad. You know who said it.
Mm-hmm.
You're a student of literature.
Mm-hmm.
So when we are seeing, when we say Otafire
failed, it's a book called Betraying the
Citizens. If you think Otafire failed to marshal support to Mbushenyi, then you're not understanding the problem of the nation that Otafire also must grapple with.
Mm.
Let's go to Teso. At the time when we are romanticizing those leaders then, the Katibat of Buangores, the economy of Teso and Afito Nus was very robust. We could never go to a butcher to buy meat. It was at home. If it is going to Kisubi, one bull was enough. But you're dealing with a Teso that is traumatized economically, socially, and politically. Traumatized. And traumatized by the same leadership you want him to them to challenge. So when the
Mukura... Would everybody agree, because there are towns emerging around Teso, that Soroti is not the only town, and even Soroti has expanded.
That is not even... That's, again, we shall go to another debate. We're talking about leadership. I talk about conditions necessary for leadership to come up. At that time, you even had the cassava called the Buana Terak. It would stay underground for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
Today we have a Nigerian which works in 6 months. So in terms of the food security alone, the population is exposed to desperation. Now, when a Mukula even gets an opportunity to go to Luzira, instead of coming out and saying, now,
purgatory.
I have gone through purgatory, let me take on this one. He says, I'm not ready.
Mm.
Because he who pays the piper dictates the tune. And it's not about Mukula. It goes to Otafire, it goes to any other leader. What do? They have to sing praise to the Alpha May. Because the conditions on the ground, if Otafire said it today, I disagree with you.
How come that Alpha Male...
They are underdogs.
How come that Alpha Male...
One, they dupe no others.
No. How come that Alpha Male overcame those same challenges that existed?
He overcame using firepower.
Mm.
First, you must accept.
And
Ugandans were subdued by Museveni, not through the vote, but through firepower.
You mean the
I think it's a matter of principle. Yoweri Museveni, at certain junctures of Uganda's history, had choices to make. During the UNLF era, he could have easily struck a deal with the UNLA, the Obote, so to say, and stayed in government. I mean, people have been striking those kind of deals with him. But he chose not to go for the issue options. He chose to go for the other options.
But I don't want to say, because Onapito became rich by waylaying people.
Mm.
So let us use waylaying people as a way to get wealth.
There was a question. The question is, how did Dr. Kanobi Kizza-Besigye make it? If you say all of us were subdued. Because,
again, not to undermine Kizza-Besigye. Kizza-Besigye has not made it.
No, I don't know.
You realize why Dr. Besigye is getting overwhelmed? Because they have increasingly denied him a backyard.
But you accept it as
even in Kigezi, the work that Museveni has done to make sure that Besigye does not get overwhelmed support.
You have two people here. Ekiza Besigye, who defied the orders.
Mm.
Yoweri Museveni, who devised the odds.
Yes.
He refused to cut deals when he had an opportunity. He refused to accept he had a good job in State House at his time.
You see the kind
he
of
would fear. Have fallen for the same comforts at that stage that you're saying now denies.
We are all now calling for those political matters. That's what you are saying. And I talk about political matters. Political matterdom in Uganda. Over my dead body, not many are willing.
Gentlemen, we promised our
viewers.
We promised our viewers.
So, what does Museveni do? Mwangusha wants to become a power in Itoro. If you in cabinet, he drops you. Then he brings in a peculiar addition. He makes him an MP.
And Chris, it's about individual survival. Everybody wants to survive.
We need to be able to move on. We need to keep our promises.
Yes.
Because you said we're looking at other issues that dominated news headlines. And we're running pretty short of time. So, we're going to run around the table. And each of you guys makes a quick comment. President Yoweri Museveni, the things that have dominated news, one is what they're calling the monster maid. I would be hesitant to judge her now without hearing a side of the story. The one who was seen on a YouTube video that has trended all over the world, I've seen discussion on it on The Guardian. I've seen it on the BBC, on the Voice of America, all over the world. They've been discussing it. The issue of the maid and that video. There was another one that also kind of dominated. President Museveni made that statement at the closure of the Tourism Association conference when he said Uganda is a better...
Uganda is better than Spain.
Picking up a discussion that started in 2012 when the Spanish Prime Minister, Rajoy, said Uganda is not... Spain is not Uganda.
Uganda, yes.
That discussion. And the last one we'll discuss will be the issue we should have discussed last week, Chris, of the baby who was killed at KCCA. Let me start with you on the three issues and how they have kind of carved out their own space.
Quick one.
We didn't discuss Desire Luzinda. We're not going to that because that was the other week.
Look, on the issue of the baby, I mean the maid who tortured the child, of course it's something to be totally condemned. Nobody can. But I think the bigger debate should go to the fate of the African or the Ugandan child today in a so-called modern society. The setting in which that baby was being tortured is totally unnatural for the African baby. The African baby grew up in an extended family.
Yeah.
There was no opportunity for an individual to touch a baby, you know, because you always had other people around. But because
You've replaced that with a spy camera that is somewhere
in
the corner.
Mm. Because of the way now we are structuring, capitalism is driving us into nucleus families. We cannot afford to have that extended family. Or we have chosen. Some of us can afford.
No, we actually do.
We can afford. If you can buy a spy camera, you could as well have some relatives around.
No, but Ona, you say that because the contradiction between that is what I have seen as a kind of hypocrisy from our leaders or people in positions of responsibility. Mm. The police, the entire chain of the police, has issued statements about that baby, Anela.
Of course.
The minister for gender and social development has issued a statement. Mm. Everyone is talking about it. No one is talking about the KCCA baby because you're talking about that extended social structure net.
Not only
the baby at the KCCA gate was brought by a grandmother. To a mother, and that is what you're talking about.
The hypocrisy is there in all of us, not just that baby. There are millions of other babies. In this city alone, you see street children.
Actually, babies being on that very week. No.
There are babies all over the streets.
They recovered the body of a baby here at Kola Airstrip. That has spent there a week. Nobody got to know about this.
So the cry of the babies is very loud. And really, if you want to respond as society, we need to do some soul searching because they represent the innocence of society. And if that innocence is being punctured, then we are really in trouble.
Yes, Ona, you wanted to come in. This different approach, without taking anything away from baby Anila, who has dominated, I have seen reviews in newspapers, I have seen everybody speaking, and the baby who died at KCCA has been forgotten. Is it because of the stations in life the two babies find themselves in? But what does it say about the broader question of what Ona Peter calls the innocence in life and directly the future of this country?
Of course, it is unfortunate that the two incidents concerning the babies happened. Concerning the maid, it is totally wrong to touch a kid of that nature who cannot not defend herself.
Do you know if the maid was tortured herself?
Yeah, if a maid... look, if you have issues with Wanambwa, it's rather you deal with me than you going for any member of my family. So if the maid had issues with the two parents, she should have settled their differences with them rather than you waiting for them to go away, then you go for this innocent soul. The KCCA incident, when I was told this boy kid came with was arrested with a mother, but which happens not to be true, it was an unfortunate incident that the kid was run over by a car.
Was brought
Of course, like Minister for Kampala and the powers that be at KCCA have said, the negligence bit goes to the authorities who are on duty at that time. Mm. Why they resisted giving a baby to the mother to breastfeed, and they preferred the baby to play around without anybody monitoring over it. So that was the unfortunate incident. But like you have said, why babies now? It's because of the two incidents. But there are so many atrocities being committed against these babies. you're working class parents, like Ona said, you have a single maid, you have left her home, you don't know whether she has given a kid milk, a kid has eaten food, you just come, you are tired, you go to bed. So basically these kids are growing up without the knowledge of the parent. It's the maids we recruit who are doing the work.
And of course there are very many maids out there who are motherly and taking good care of the babies. Chris, on these two babies, what's the difference?
Charles, that is a very emotive subject for me, and I've told you that off air. I don't want to downplay the gravity of the offense committed against baby Anela. But I don't want us to create a society of us against maids. Seven likes talking about isolated incidents. Maybe that's an isolated incident. Maids themselves go through a lot of torture from us, the middle class.
Working class.
And the working class, the so-called working class, which they shouldn't be. And most of the children of poor Ugandans are in towns under the guise of helping the working class. And they are going through a lot of torture. And the state is not bothering about them. The torture of that baby is wrong. Nobody can accept that. But I frown at the selfishness and the hypocrisy of Uganda's so-called middle class, that they are able to rise up in uproar, including the ministers, including the young Kibule, running around to Kiwatule with the cameras, mobilizing the media, which I'm going to comment later.
You are talking about a man with the two wives.
Whatever he calls himself.
Respect him.
I see everybody wanting to use a statement on that baby. Charles, the suffering children of northern Uganda, the children of Ankole, as we speak, are seen to be the most malnourished. Ankole, why we assume there is milk? In northern Uganda, the northern children have been raped. The middle class has never come to the uproar.
And they've been forgotten
and
now.
And that kind of middle class is the one which is going to keep Uganda perpetually under the alpha male. Because they rise with emotions and they cool like porridge. They become useless. So we must understand the problem.
Are you sure we shall not have an alpha female?
When we see the issue like KCCA, you have seen a juxtaposition. This is the life goal of a poor woman. No uproar because the mother is poor. Perhaps Anela because she's already a middle class baby. I'm not saying her problem is small, but why don't we have the same uproar on this woman? People talk about it's an accident. You see, now KCCA was an accident. But Charles.
And maybe the other one was also an accident.
Exactly. Why don't you think there's an accident? But now KCCA, an accident. And the manner in which KCCA has treated this thing makes KCCA has become an area of ritual sacrifice. To me, I call that a ritual sacrifice. The blood of that kid will haunt anybody who runs KCCA. And I keep asking a question. Why should ordering cities become blood-sucking exercise?
I think it's not only babies. Look at the way they manhandled.
For who does KCCA want to develop Kampala? That question will be answered. Do we want Kampala as a New York? Do we want Kampala as an African city? There must be
even New York has its poor people, yes, and listen, it has space for them.
New York develops according to the New York culture. Charles, in Kampala, we have maids who are poorly paid. In Kampala, we have Napitos who want to take Maroa. We must find a place for Maroa.
Ajol, to be precise.
Ajol. We want Polo to take Tonto. Where is the Tonto in Kampala? Kampala is turning everybody into a certain European. And they think, we have been to Belgium, this is how it works. Kampala is not Belgium. We want to
Uganda
see a city.
Is not Spain.
It's not Spain.
Spain is not Uganda.
I want to see a city which accommodates my person from Kigezi. When he comes here, they want roasted meat. What kind of home do we have? Do we have a home where you can have a place to roast meat? Do you have a home where you can have a fireplace? Now, Musisi simply, with all her attributes, is an agent of capitalism, driven by the fanatism of capitalists. Kampala should not be developed for economic hitmen. They should be developed for Namaganda. You're blaming her for vending in the streets. Where do you want her to get an income in an economy where we say it is a private sector-led economy? We have created the conditions, exploit the conditions. This lady left Masaja to exploit the conditions in town. Why do you beat her? Why do you beat her?
We need to come in a little bit more. Because
on that video, go and tell your that the approach is wrong.
Whereas people are happy with the changes that Musisi has created in Kampala, the question that Chris raises, for whom is Kampala developing?
For the economic hitmen.
It's definitely Kampala shouldn't be devolved. We shouldn't look at it because we're sitting on TV and we're discussing. Then we want a nice Kampala where we're not going to be disturbed. No, the approach, I saw this baby going to be buried. And I saw the kind of compensation. And I'm wondering if there is someone out there who's going to raise this issue with the mother and ask more questions.
Kampala, capital city. For me, I have a different view from Obore. I don't think Uganda is Kampala. And I don't believe a city is for all Ugandans. I mean, we have a very wonderful countryside. One of the crises this country is going through now, which may even could cause real food shortage, is this massive movement of people into the cities and urban centers. People are abandoning agriculture. We say that agriculture is disorganized, yes, but there are people who are living worse lives in the city than they would live in the countryside. If they dedicated similar effort, someone will go to a construction site, work for I don't know how many hours, and go away with the 10,000. Mm. If he worked in the field for the same length of hours, there is no way he could fail to earn.
Someone will raise a question and say 15 years ago, people who live in central Uganda, in Chireka, in Namugongo, were in the village. The city has grown and found them there. No conditions have been created for them to transform with that city and be able to benefit from it. How do you deal with them?
Look, and that's part of the problem. I'm saying, when you glorify city life, you know, when the city moves, I'm saying people who cannot adapt
Charles, let me tell you about Bunyoro. Just this week, MTV here was running a feature of women who were being dispossessed from the land they were born in Bunyoro. Because your hitmen have gone to hit land in the villages. So we cannot be condemning the poor that are unable to craft a living, when where they are supposed to construct their livelihoods is being encroached by the same hitman who are in Kampala.
Our time is up, gentlemen. We need to get up to that. One quick comment from you, Wana.
I think on that issue, like Wana says, there's the economic war is setting in. You cannot blame the poor, but again, you cannot blame the rich. If you have the money, you will go. What do people do? Even the villages, Manafa down there, the town has moved to Manafa. Where people used to bury, they no longer bury. That is a town. What people are surviving on is sell that plot of land, right the border. The following day, you are knocked, you are dead. Nowhere to go.
Our time is out. We need to get out of here. Looking at the KCCA baby and baby Anila, and we haven't had opportunity to discuss.
You can't pay $2 million for somebody's
Uganda
baby.
Is a better tourist destination than Spain. I agree with the president entirely.
Because
I think this country is amazing. It's beautiful. But the that it gets back to that debate.
When they are stealing ivory. In the headquarters here.
Our time is out.
Stealing ivory.
We need to get out of here. Chris, I recommend that you look for an essay by Jonathan Swift called A Modest Proposal and read it. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. And thank you very much, gentlemen. Have a good night.
Thank you.